Now we'll go to liquefaction. Liquefaction, I think you already know what liquefaction is. So it is a short term process that happens when a mass of, these are some of the important terms I will highlight within this. So so liquefaction is a few things that you should remember within this. It is a short term process, mass of saturated sediment. So you need saturated sediment, saturated with what? Water. And it is affected by shock like an earthquake. So these are the three important terms that you should remember within this. And they become momentarily liquid. So the sediment that is saturated in water under shock, it will behave like a liquid, viscous fluid. And there is usually only very localized movement of sediments during liquefaction. During liquefaction, grain lose contact with one another and the shear strength of sediments becomes almost zero. So this is the process which is known as liquefaction. So I'll show you what liquefaction actually looks like in this video. So you see, now these sediments, now this crane, what is doing? It is doing the job of a shock or vibration. And these vibrations are actually the sediment that is there. It is behaving like a liquid. It is not behaving like a solid. So what are the structures that you will form due to liquefaction? So first one is convolute bedding and convolute lamination. So they are sort of like, if it is in millimeter scale, lamination is usually millimeter scale. Very thin means very thin. So if it is centimeter scale, you'll call it bedding. So it is thick. Bedding is thick. And lamination is thin. So the layers within sediment can be disrupted. So all, even if they were flat, originally horizontal, but if localized liquefaction takes place, they can become deformed or they can change their shape. After deposition by localized small scale liquefaction of material, the structures range from slight over steepening of cross strata to development of highly folded and contorted layers called convolute lamination and convolute bedding. So this is what you see here. So originally these were, let's say, deposited horizontally, and due to liquefaction they become in form of a small folds, which is known as convolute bedding. The folds in the layering tend to be asymmetric with noses of anticlinings pointing downslope or in direction of flow. So again, just like we saw with slumps, so these noses of anticlines, they point in downslope direction. And convolute lamination is particularly, just like slumps, it is particularly common in turbidites, where it can be seen within laminated and cross laminated parts of beds. We have already seen this. So this is again same thing that we studied in previous slide, and these are just some other examples of convolute bedding, live examples. So these you see here, these are examples of convolute lamination, where you see this. So this was an already, so you see there are some cross stratified strata here. See these. So this is already cross stratified and laminated layer. So this is laminated. So you see these layers are there. This laminated layer has become converted to convolute bedding. Same thing is happening within this zone. So these are evidences that this layer at some point was liquefied. Another thing that can happen is during this stage is that you can get overturned strata within this layer also. Let's go to previous setting only, how it can get overturned. So you all know that at the bottom you will have older and near the top you will have younger strata. So if you follow this top bed here, it is doing something like this. And if you follow, I'm going to this older bed here. This is older bed. It is doing something like this. So what will happen is, if you normally go from top to bottom, so first you will hit younger and then you will hit older. But if you go in this region, so here older is on top and younger is at base. So if I have to draw it again more clearly, it is, if you have something in this, let's say within this zone, this is your younger bed and this is your older bed into red. So what is happening to your younger bed? This is again younger bed, and these are your older bed. So if you drill here, so your shallow will be old and deep will be young. So this type of beds, they are known as overturned beds. So overturned coarse cross stratification is also an evidence of liquefaction, but I mean it is not the only process that creates overturned cross strata. There are many other processes that can create cross strata. So sands deposited by avalanching down lee slope of sub aqueous dunes are closely packed and saturated with water. They are easily liquefied and can be deformed by shear stress caused by during strong current and over a set of cross beds. Shearing of upper part of cross beds creates a characteristic form called recumbent cross bedding or overturned cross stratification. Recumbent means, so these are slightly different from what we are. So this was just for giving you example. So but what exactly is happening here is the sands deposited by avalanching on lee slope of subaqueous. So you remember these subaqueous dunes, how they form. So if this is a dune, this is your stoss side and this is your lee side. And how do sediments deposit here? So these sediments, they are carried. So this is your movement, direction of movement. So they are carried from stop, and they this process which happens is there is known as avalanching within these dunes. So these subaqueous dunes means they are under water. So they are easily liquefied and deformed by shear stress caused by strong current over cross beds. And shearing of upper part of cross bed. So how will be the cross beds formed here? Due to this migration, your cross beds will be like this. So these are the cross beds within this subaqueous dune. So shearing of the upper part of cross beds creates a characteristic form called recumbent. So this upper part, which is here, it can get from here, it can form, it can be deformed by liquefaction like this. And this type of recumbent cross stratification is usually called overturned cross stratification, because within this, these younger strata are at the base and older strata are on top. Now you already studied what is liquefaction. There is another process which is known as fluidization. So sometimes people can confuse between these process. What is liquefaction? What is fluidization? So again, I have another video for you. So before you we study this, let's just look at the video. So see here. So this is what is fluidization. This is the fluidization process. Just look at this example. So what is happening here? You have these layers, you see different layers, they have some density contrast within them, and because of compaction, what is happening, some water will be, so if you apply pressure, some water is expelled. So now you'll see this. So they are introducing some fluid from base. So this is the process of fluidization. So this will usually, how will this happen, that we'll now study. So when sediment is deposited in marine environment, it is saturated with water, and many continental deposits are also saturated. So both in marine setting as well as in continental setting, you can have deposits which are saturated with water. Saturated means 100% or all of it is covered, all of the pores, they are filled with water. So there is no empty pore space. And burial related overburden pressure leads to gradual expulsion of pore water. So if this is a layer, and due to overburden pressure, what will happen? It will become thinner. So how will it become thinner? That pores will, the pore space will be reduced due to rearrangement. So the grains can rearrange themselves into an arrangement which occupies less overall volume, and in the process, because matrix, you cannot compress it, so it is incompressible. So most of the volume decrease that is happening is due to reduction in pore volume, and all these pores, they are filled with water. So how will reduction in pore volume takes place? All the pore water that is present, it will be expelled out. So if this is normally taking place slowly and slowly water is expelled out, you will not see fluidized beds. Fluidized beds you will usually see if, let's say, this pore water is not allowed to escape. So what will happen, let's say this sedimentary, original sedimentary layers, it is covered around by impermeable shale. So let's say this I will write as permeable, and it is covered on top and bottom by impermeable. So what will happen is, now volume is reducing, but pore water is not allowed to, because it is, let's say, on all sides it is surrounded by impermeable material. So pore water is not allowed to go out. So what will happen is, slowly and slowly pore water pressure will keep on building up. It is just like if you have a balloon in your hand and you press it from all sides, and pressure inside balloon will keep on building up. So what is happening is, if water gets trapped within a layer by an impermeable bed above, what trapped water can become overpressured. What is overpressured setting? Let's say you have pressure is given by rho g h, if there is no extra pressure. So if you have pressure where h is depth, so if your pressure which is given by this equation, then it is a normal pressure or hydrostatic pressure. But if you have a pressure which is more than hydrostatic pressure, it is known as overpressure. So, and what happens is, let's say now this becomes overpressured, but within this setting, let's say there is some crack develops here. So what will happen is, all the water that is trapped under pressure, it will suddenly rush through that crack. So when a crack in the overlying layer, it allows fluid to be released and travel at high velocity. Just like you saw that in video, water from below or gas from below was traveling at high velocity. And this rapidly moving pore water causes fluidization of sediment, which is carried upwards with the moving water. Fine sediments can be more easily carried upward, so the process of eutrophication occurs as fine sand is carried away by fluid, leaving behind coarse material and more cohesive material. So again, remember, one mark objective question can be asked on this: what is eutrophication? So let's say you have a rock here which has coarse grained sediments and it has these fine grained sediments. And what is happening due to fluidization of some bed below? So there is some bed below which gets, so let's say this is your shale and there is another coarse bed here which gets fluidized due to this crack which is developing here. So if you have a crack here and all this water is rushing up. So this rushing, the water that is rushing up, it will carry all the fine grained, these fine grained, because they are easy to mobilize. So these fine grained sediments, they will be carried away. So what will be left behind? You will only be left behind with coarse grained sediments, only coarse grained. So this process is known as eutrophication. So this is sort of like a salting which is produced, but this is not due to depositional processes, but due to fluidization process. So some of the structures that you will see due to fluidization, they are usually covered under dish and pillar structures. So these structures due to fluidization often called dewatering. So they are also called dewatering structures because water is escaping and they result from the expulsion of pore water from a bed. These structures are concave disruptions to the layering in sediments a few centimeter to tens of centimeters across. So their dimensions will be maybe 2-3 centimeters, 5 centimeters to 30-40-50 centimeters. They are formed by upward movement of fluid. Pillar structures, also known as eutrophication process, we already studied what this process is. They are vertical water escape channels that can be simple tubes or have vertical sheet like form. So water from below is escaping up. So this type of thing that you are seeing, this is known as pillar, or this can also be known as eutrophication pipe. And dish is like, if you see some of these tops, so these concave disruptions that you see here, if you look for a moment, they are known as dish structures. So what you are seeing here, for example, this structure that you are seeing here, this is a dish. So I'll write it here, this is a dish and this is a pillar. Another structure due to, again we are in fluidization only, another process that you can get due to fluidization are clastic dikes. So what is difference between pillar? So pillar is formed when it is moving through some crack, but if there is fluidization of a large body of sediment in subsurface can result in infiltration of sediments in form of vertical clastic dikes. So this is the same process that is happening, but how is difference from previous process? They form when a fracture occurs above an underwater pressure band and water rushes, what upward rush of pore water carries sediment into the crack. So this crack is pre-existing. So there is already, let's say there is a fault plane or some fracture or the joint is there, and water from below is rushing upwards. This will form a clastic dike. So this, you see, you remember if you from igneous petrology, dikes, cross cut, strata. So someone if looks, so this is your sedimentary layering and this dike is cross cutting it. So someone can confuse them from igneous dike, but if you look at the material here, these will be sediment. So that is why they are known as clastic dikes. Unlike pillar, so how are they different from pillars? So pillars will usually be more cylindrical, whereas these are more sheet-like in three dimensions. So these will be something like this, clastic dikes. So these are pillars, these are clastic dikes, because they are forming along pre-existing fractures or crack, which are more planar features. And finally, again, this is another structure due to fluidization. So all this material, as you are seeing, so these beds are there and all this material is carried to the top. If it reaches the surface, let's say this is your land surface. So it reaches the surface, what you will get is sand volcanoes and extruded dikes. So sand volcanoes are created by pillar structures or alliteration pipes, and these extruded sheets are caused by dikes. So extrusion means, you see already extrusion rocks is studied already. So these are means they have extruded out to the surface. So if fluidized sediment is brought to the surface by isolated pipes, it forms a small sand or mud volcano. And if sediment is brought to the surface by dikes or clastic dikes, it is known as extruded sheets. So again, I have a video for you. You can see this. So what are these? Mud volcano. So see, so this is a mud volcano. So all the fluidized material that is coming from below, it is extruding to the surface. So if pipes are bringing that surface, it is known as mud volcano, and if sheets are bringing this fluidized material to the surface, they are known as extruded sheets. So this is, we are done with soft sediment deformation. Do you have any questions? Okay, everything under this. I think these are easier topics that you are studying these days. Okay, anyone else? Any questions you might have? Okay, yeah, that is a good question. So what type of environment? So fluidization and these type of structures you are seeing, where are they developing mostly? So what is the first, you'll see, you need saturated sediments. So that is the first condition. So that means 100% of pore space is filled with water. So this is what do you mean by saturated? And the second condition depends on whether you have fluidized or liquefaction. So fluidization, what is the condition for fluidization? So you have a permeable bed which is covered by impermeable layer which will from all sides which will not allow water to escape. So these type of settings, if you remember, and liquefaction, what is the second condition for liquefaction? You need some shock. So liquefaction deposits, they can occur in many depositional settings, right? But they are more common usually because where will you have these sediments which are completely saturated with water? These are usually present in marine settings, for example turbidites, those sort of deposits. But you will see them in both continental and marine, wherever you have soft sediment. So they are not restricted, they are not really restricted to a particular setting. But if you look at these, see any of the deformation structures that you have studied, they are not restricted to any particular. If conditions are right, they can form in any settings. It's only like some of the things that we were seeing, for example slumps and all, they are more common in deltaic successions, and those load structures, flame structures, they are more common in turbidites. So why? And this same is for fluidization. So because usually in, for example in turbidites, sediments are saturated with water. Another thing that happens within these turbidites is, if you remember Boma sequence, how this Boma sequence looks is, you remember you have this base which is sandy and on top it is capped by muds. This is sand, and then there will be second setting, and then there will be third. So you have mud, and this is sand. So what is happening in turbidites is, if you look at layers, so you have these extensive sheets of alternating layers of sand and mud. So sand and mud, again sand and mud. So you study what was the condition for fluidization, that you have a permeable and impermeable layer, so that when you are compressing this, so if you provide overburden pressure to this, so this will get compressed, and pore water that is present within these pores here, it will become over pressured, but it cannot go out, because where will it try to go? It will try to go up, but above, for example if you look at this sand layer, below is shale, above on top of it is shale, so the water cannot escape, so over pressure will develop. So whenever you see some crack here, the water can escape out under high pressure, high velocity. So that is why these are more common in turbidites. But that doesn't mean that you cannot find them in other settings. You can also find them in deltaic setting also. For example, but in deltaic, this alternating sequences are not very common. If you remember, wherever you have turbidites, this, and whenever this turbidite deposit is not there, what is deposited instead? You have these hemipelagic muds. So those hemipelagic muds are also causing this alternating layers of sand and shale. So that is why they are more common in turbidites. Delta, for example, you have this overall. So first, what will be the condition in delta? Maybe you have these sandbars you studied. There will be thick deposits of sand, maybe very few layers of shale in between. So those are not really, right conditions for fluidization. So turbidites, it is most common, but that doesn't mean it cannot happen in other settings. Any other questions? So everyone satisfied? Okay, so I have already sent you these slides. I will send those because I prepared them just before the class only, those carbonate platforms. I'll send those slides also. Okay. All right. Okay. Bhargav, did you ask something? Skype. Okay. Okay. So no further questions. So we'll close. this lecture, and if you have any questions, further questions, you can text me on WhatsApp also. Okay.